Good morning, everyone. This is Jim Chastain with EasyPower. Welcome to our Thursday technical webinar. We appreciate your time and your attendance this morning. Today's topic is arc flash mitigation with fuses. And before I introduce our guest speaker, as we normally do, I would like to run a quick poll, set of poll questions that will help us direct some of this dialogue, and I think it may be of interest as we introduce our guest speaker. The first is pretty straightforward. That is, how frequently do you have to calculate incident energy involving fuses? So appreciate your feedback on this. Looks like we've got a majority of attendees now. Good. And here's how people are relaying feedback. Next question is a little bit less straightforward, but very much more interesting, or as much interesting. And so the question is, how often or have you been involved as an expert witness in a legal case? And again, I'd expect most of us to say no to this, so I'll be curious to the feedback myself. All right, appreciate that. And at this point, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, Mr. Peter Walsh, who is an expert in electrical forensic engineering, and we're very happy to have him involved in our presentation. So with that, let me turn the presentation over to him.
This is Peter Walsh. I am going to talk about arc flash mitigation with fuses today. I am with Technical Associates, LLC. I'm an expert witness and so forth, and we are going to make up for our lost time. So this is a little bit about my background. I'm a member of several technical committees, including Guide for Performing Arc Flash Calculations and other organizations. I've served with IEEE, NFPA, with National Electrical Code Making Process. One of the interesting things about my background is that I have over 24 years combined service with MERS and embusment. Probably if you are a very experienced engineer, Merson was called Farrar-Sharmat and Gould-Sharmat, and Bussmann was called Bussmann, Bussmann Division of McGraw Edison, Cooper Industries, Eaton, whatever. But the two companies are the major fuse companies, and I have more than 24 years. I'm not speaking as a fuse manufacturer. I'm not speaking as a committee member. I'm not giving any official position or interpretation or any detailed information about a particular manufacturer. If you have a particular application and you want it checked out, I suggest that you refer to the manufacturer, Merson or Bussmann, or whoever the manufacturer is. So, the overview of today's presentation is UL low voltage fuse standards current limitation, and that's a conceptual thing that's hard to understand if, unless you have somebody to explain it to you. Regions of time current curve, time delay, no intentional time delay. Medium voltage, this is a concept, and if we run behind on time. We will shorten this conceptual thing down to make the time fit. So if we go on to the next slide, common UL fuse types. And there are a lot of UL fuse types, but we are going to review the most common ones. You can see that I have a chart here. On the left, we have non-current limiting, 0 to 600 amps, class H, class K, which is the most common type today. Current limiting, 0 to 600 amps. Class RK, class J are very common, and you can see the arrows emanating down to have some examples. Class J is typically a smaller product, and it's typically used in control panels, and these fuse sizes are typically used in power distribution, most control centers and so forth. These are the large fuses, 601 to 6,000 amps. Actually, the 601 or 800 case size, which is the same physical dimensions, have been UL listed to even lower amperes, like 400 amps, 200 amps, and so forth, to enable downsizing in some existing equipment. And these are the small fuses, the midget dimensions, class CC. So those are the most common fuses that we will see in power distribution. Common fuse characteristics are listed on the left, and I'm going to talk on the right here. The most common amp ratings are 1/10 through 6,000 amps. You can have more or less, but those are the common amp ratings. Maximum voltage rating, AC and or it's DC. A fuse could have both a AC and DC rating, and they could be different. A common rating would be 600 volts AC and maybe 500 volts DC. It all depends upon the manufacturer and the model and so forth. The next thing is interrupting rating, amps interrupting capacity. The basic branch of circuit fuses that you get at a hardware store are 10,000 amps interrupting rating. The specification grade are 300,000. And it's important to note that the interrupting rating is at ready conditions, such as the not exceeding the voltage. So you could have a 600 volt fuse and use it in a 480 volt circuit and would have the interrupting rating as marked on it. If you have it applied over 600 amps, the interrupting rating is non-applicable because it's not being used properly with voltage. The next thing is time delay or fast acting. UL has some standards. The most common thing is that 5 times the fuse's rating for 10 seconds and the fuse won't open. With more than 10 seconds, all bets are off, it will open. Degree of current limitation. The UL standards set minimum performance. Mechanical dimensions. UL standards have all the interchangeability mechanical dimensions and manufactured brand names. So those are the things that are important with a fuse. This is a condensed UL branch circuit rated device, fuse class comparison. You can see that HK5 and RK5 are shown in black, and all the typical fuses and so forth in these classes are shown in black because they are older classes and they are not the best ones for mitigation of arc flash. And just go through them, RK1 and J are the best ones for arc flash. The amps interrupting rating, 10,000 amps, 50,000 amps, 200. Most of them have 300,000, but it's not really in the UL standard. The UL standard only goes up to 200. Current limitation, none in the H. K5 some, RK5 some, and RK1 and J are the best. Overload region, well, if you say zero times the rating up to 10 times the rating of the fuse, that's the overload region, and all these fuses have the same overload region. We are going to see some graphs with the time current curves, and there is a region that is no intentional time delay, and that's over 10 times the fuse rating. And the current limiting region in the Class H fuse has none, no current limitation. K5, RK5, you have to go over 65 times the fuse's rating to start the current limiting. And RK1 and J, you have to go over 30 times. So we will examine in more detail some of the individual ratings, but let's start with a basic RK5 time delay fuse, which is an old fuse design that's very common, and everybody has them if they have a fuse inventory. On the left, with a light blue-gray, it has a overload element that is spring-loaded. And this collapses by a spring when it gets hot enough. It's an electromechanical device, something like a overload heater on a motor starter, and it is not resettable. And it is sensitive to overload currents, but it has time delay, intentional time delay. Section G, the short circuit element, has no time delay, but it's set maybe 10 times the fuse's rating, and then it has no intentional time delay. So let's look at a slightly different construction of the RK1 time delay fuse. You can see that we still have a short circuit strip, and we have a plunger electromechanical assembly that disconnects the fuse when it has an overload. So typically, up to 700% of the fuse's rating is handled this with intentional time delay. With the short circuit strip at 10 times the fuse's rating, this will open. And it's interesting with analysis of what went wrong, an accident, whatever, you can determine by doing analysis of the fuse what happened to cause, or the duration and the level of current which opened the fuse. This is an X-ray, which is a non-destructive test for court cases. And with some experience, you can see that the current was great enough to open up the short circuit strip, but not great enough to completely disintegrate it. This is disassembled. This is a destructive test. You have to open up the fuse. But you can determine the opening current and the duration by forensic analysis. It's a permanent change in the fuse by the current and the duration. And that could be very useful in determining the sequence of events which happened first in an accident or incident. Now, current limitation. We are striving to deliver the concept of current limitation, and we will review the effect on incident energy. Well, the definition of a current limiting overcurrent protected device is in the National Electrical Code, and it's pretty straightforward. If it doesn't seriously decrease the level of the current, it's not a current limiting device, and it has to do it every time with certain magnitudes of current. So this is one of the big takeaways from this seminar. Incident energy is proportional to the arc current squared times the seconds or time if all the other variables are constant. So if you had the same circuit and if you had one half the time, you would have one half the incident energy. If you had the same time as the base case and we had one half the current, one half times one half is one quarter, you would have one fourth the incident energy. So with the duration and the current, you can do things with mitigating arc flash hazards. Actually, if you had lower currents, if the time were extended enough, you would have increased incident energy. So you kind of have to check it both ways. So what we are talking about is reducing incident energy by properly applying current limiting fuses. And it's a very, very effective solution when fault levels are high, such as New York City, the fault levels at 208, 480 are very, very high. So we have a graph of current limitation. And the current limitation is, this is the normal current going through. At this instant, a short circuit occurs. And when that occurs, we have a lot of current, a large current loop in the first half cycle. And if we have a properly applied current limiting device, we'll see the current starts up as it normally does because the fuse is low resistance, but the current is forced down by the fuse and actually can reach a current zero before the first half of the cycle. So normally, a non-current limiting device would have the full half current loop and more, a typical low-cost circuit breaker would operate in 1.5 cycles, 3 half cycles, and some of the bigger ones could have 6 cycles to interrupt the current, and it will go as high as the indicated calculations say. But with the current limiting fuse properly applied, it will cut off at this area. The current limitation comparison with the old style fuse, well, a Class H fuse would have no current limitation, but RK5, which is the most common fuse, has this much current limitation, and the recommended RK1 and J, and when I'm saying RK5 and RK1 and J, I'm referring to the UL classification, not anybody's manufacturer's part number. So you can see that the recommended ones are more effective at reducing the peak current, and they are acting quicker. Now, what does that mean? In a 100 amp UL class RK5, the UL standards allow 50,000 I2T maximum. And we said that I2T is proportional to the incident energy if everything else is held constant. With the RK1, with the UL classification, it's limited to 10,000 instead of 50,000, and that's a 80% reduction by replacing the fuses with a different UL category, and they have the same mechanical dimensions. So it's not rocket science to replace the fuse. Part 3, we are going to look at the regions of the fuse time current curve. The time delay region, that's normally up to 10 times of the fuse's rating. The no intentional time delay region, which is more than 10 times the fuse's rating. And the current limitation region, which varies. So the transition between the time delay and the no intentional time delay, and this slide is based on a question from the last time I gave the seminar. They were asking questions about the time current curve. This is a 100 amp fast acting fuse curve here. This is a time delay, and probably you remember with UL, maybe I didn't say at this seminar, 5 times the normal current rating would be 500 amps with a 100 amp fuse. So the fast acting fuse will be operating in about 1 second. The time delay fuse would be operating in about 15 seconds. The UL standard for most fuses would be 10 seconds, at least 10 seconds. Now, these time current curves are valid for the current. It has nothing to do with the voltage. The sensitive elements within the fuse are sensitive to the current heating effect within the fuse. It doesn't make any difference for the time current curve whether it's high voltage, low voltage, regardless. However, when it comes time to interrupt the circuit, that's the time the voltage is very, very important. If you have over-applied the fuse, like a 250-volt fuse and a 480-volt circuit, it will have the same time current curve, but when it tries to open, it could explode because it doesn't have the voltage rating for the interrupting rating. So we see time delay region up to about 10 times, and after that, no intentional time delay. Now, the transition to current limitation, this is from EasyPower, and this is an RK1 and an RK5. Both of these fuse curves are time delay fuses, and it's, you can see that 5 times current, they about the same time. However, the RK1 will start to current limit at about 30 times, and the RK5 fuse will not start to current limit until 65 times. If I had shown a class H fuse, it wouldn't current limit at all. So those are the three regions in a fuse curve. Now, I had 3 questions from the prior one, and current limitation can reduce fault current for downstream components, but you have to be careful. The maximum amount of fault current let through is related to the fuse size, the amper rating, the UL classification, and the manufacturer's model. In general, you can have the busways and non-active devices protected, and that's according to UL 508A. The 3 questions up here are related to protecting circuit breakers. And because of numerous failures, because of some construction techniques of circuit breakers, you have to refer to National Electrical Code 240.86, and most of the time you have to have the fuses witness tested in combination with the circuit breaker. And once it's done, the manufacturer of the circuit breaker publishes it on their website saying, with a such and such a class of fuses, if you don't exceed a particular rating, it will be eligible for increased interrupting rating. But 240.86 has all the requirements for circuit breaker protection. Fuse curve from IEEE 1584. Notice that we have a graph showing incident energy versus bolted fault current. Not arc current, but bolted fault current. And this is the result of actual testing, not calculation. Similarly with a circuit breaker, this is the time delay region, and then if you get enough current to open up in the region of the instantaneous trip, it's a fixed time, and if the available fault current goes up, if you remember, I squared T is proportional to the incident energy. If you have the T fixed, you have the current going up, and you have more and more incident energy. A comparison with this, if you have a 6-cycle fixed time, and you have a Class J fuse, 200 amps, and the available pole current using the calculations from IEEE 1584, the incident energy doesn't go up with increasing current. But a fixed time, well, 600 volt motor control centers, for instance, if you have them supply with a maximum of a particular current limiting fuse, 800 amps for each section, many times the incident energy will be below 1.2 calories. And this is shown here. This is a this 800 amp fuse. This is a greater fuse, 1,000, 1,200. And if you have a 30,000 bolted fault current, it will translate into obviously a lesser arc fault current, but this lesser arc fault current will be in the current limitation range, and this boundary is 1.2 calories, and it will always be below 1.2 calories for arc flash. Similarly, with 1,000 and 1,200 amps, if you have 650,000 amps available pole current, you have safe conditions. And this is not by calculation, this is by actual testing, and you would have to, if you were using a Mersenne fuse, you would have to check with the manufacturer. If you were using a Bussmann fuse, you would have to check with the manufacturer. One of the things that I trap is that this testing was done typically at 600 volts. If you have an application for 480 volts or 208 volts, the incident energy, contrary to expectation, would be higher. Yes, it would be higher because 480 and 208 would have less current, and you would have to wait for more current, and the curve moves. So there is sometimes some confusion. Now, not all class L fuses are the same. These two fuses are both class L fuses, and they are from the same manufacturer. This one in yellow is made to have some time delay and extreme current limitation. This fuse is made to have additional time delay, and it has a sacrificed current limitation, and it's still within the requirements of Class L fuses. So, suggestion, standardize on current limiting fuses before data gathering for an arc flash study. Otherwise, you are susceptible to the maintenance people substituting later whatever they have in inventory or what they are buying. So if the client can standardize on fuses so that the maintenance people don't have any options, you can use this mitigation technique without any complications. If you have a mixed bag of fuses you have to assume that the maintenance people are going to put in the worst case. So with 0 to 600 amps, class RK1 time delay is the recommended fuse to standardize on. Notice that this is not a manufacturer's part number, it's a UL classification. And this, with the above 600 amps, because the class L current limitation standards are very lax, you have to go to a particular manufacturer's part number to detail it and get what you want. There was some questions last time with special fuses, not the regular standard fuses. And this one was a cable protector, CP250C3TI. And if you have low available fault current, and that translates into an arc current of only 1500 amps, this is a portion, and it's 15 seconds. It's really out there. If you had 6,000 amps, this is that point. It's 0.04 seconds, and you can use EasyPower to read off the graph and put in the correct timing. So if you had this one or an A60X or any fuse that you are using, you have to read off the chart and make sure that you are using the maximum clearing time for the arcing current, not the average time, but the maximum clearing time. There was a question about fuse maintenance to optimize reliability. Standardize on fuses to avoid misapplication. If one or two fuses operate in a three-phase circuit, replace all three because of potential hidden damage. Fuses exposed to damp conditions, even if they are dried out, the properties change. The interrupting rating is less. Or overheated fuse clips. Those types of fuses should be thrown away. Fuses in storage, not service, but just in storage, should be replaced about every 10 years to avoid fuses with concealed damage and moisture damage. And they have a visible date code. If a fuse is in service, no problem, because the heat will naturally keep it dry and people wouldn't be dropping them. Avoid salvaged or reconditioned fuses by third parties. Adding fuses to existing circuits for arc flash mitigation. Again, a question from last time. Typically accomplished by adding a fusible disconnect switch externally to a control panel supply. So it's external and it's going to have everything downstream from the fusible disconnect at a mitigated level. The reminder in this exact question, just check the existing circuit for compliance before you touch it and own it. 100% rated fuses and switches. Class L fuses are tested by UL standards to carry 100%. Some switch manufacturers list to an optional UL category for 100% loading. Could be the same switch, but they have more vents, more spacing, and so forth, but it will be marked 100%. And if the equipment is marked 100% and it's installed in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions, the assembly, including the fuses, is rated for 100% continuous. And typically, only Class L fuses are 100% rating. So we have covered the UL fuse types up to 600 volts, and we are almost out of time. So I'm going to go through this very quickly. Primary fuse selection to mitigate secondary incident energy. And this is a one line showing extreme danger. And the original fuse was a 9F62DDD. And the incident energy, the worst case was 73. And I'm going to go along here. If it were just a relay, you could adjust the curve. But some fuses have different curves with the same mounting dimensions. And you have to consider if you are going to change the fuse size, you have to go through system considerations, transformer characteristics, NEC requirements, and this slide could go on and on and on, fuse characteristics. So we are looking at an 80 amp fuse with two different characteristics, two different part numbers, and sometimes you have to be sure that the fuse would do it better. And this purple largest main or largest feeder, this is the new fuse. This was the original fuse. These fuses are still the same rating. And you can see that it's going to be much faster in this area. And the result is the original fuse application had 73 calories on the secondary of the transformer. This brought it down with this substitution down to 11 calories per centimeter squared on the secondary side of the transformer. And they have some other fuses, electronic trip, medium voltage fuses. Mersen has one. And these are special fuses on the medium voltage side to change things on the primary and have a beneficial mitigation on the secondary.
Thank you, Peter. If anyone has a requirement to see how these specifically are displayed in EasyPower, we'd be more than happy to pick that up on a Tuesday refresher session, because it may, just as Peter explained, the specific application has a bearing on how the calculations are made. All right, thank you very much. I think we'll close out the webinar, and we'll be talking to you folks down the road.
Thank you for listening and having patience with our technical difficulties.